Good evening. I certainly appreciate the opportunity to be in your august presence, if I might say so. A lot of very distinguished people, a lot of thought leaders, a lot of brain power here. And the focus of this evening's discussion is change, social change. And I believe that you all here are change agents. We have the absolute pleasure of having Dr. Wendy Luhabe and Gail Masondo as guests in Indianapolis. I have to tell you a line or two about the organization with which I'm affiliated so that you would have some sort of a context. It is 6 years in existence, going on 6 years in existence. It's Saving Orphans Through Healthcare and Outreach. The website is savingorphans.com. And the focus of our organization is working in communities that are significantly impacted by HIV and AIDS, working first of all with the orphans and vulnerable children, and with our specific target on child-headed households that is becoming an increasing problem. We take a very holistic approach to what we do. We have to. We are involved in looking after the health care of children. We're looking after education, scholarship support and mentoring, and psychosocial support, skills building. In order to do this, we have established an international network of collaborators, universities, hospital groups, different ones, and together we're sitting around a table and saying, let's start with a small place, a small kingdom like Swaziland. We work elsewhere also, but we focus there. And let us see, in this country the size of New Jersey, with the highest AIDS infection rate in the entire world, what can we do to effect change? And some exciting things are happening there. But my task this evening, my privilege this evening, is just telling you a line or two about the women we honored. Last year when we had our event, we honored Dr. Gebisa Ijeta, the winner of the World Food, the 2009 World Food Prize laureate. We wanted a woman this year, and we were fortunate enough to have two. Wendy Luhabe is not only a thought leader, and as her bio indicates, recognized as one of the 50 leading social entrepreneurs in the world. But what she is a woman that I could personally respect, a woman who inspires, because in the DVD that PBS put together to introduce her, her final words were, "There is not a single desire to do good that I have not fulfilled. There is not a thought to produce something that I have not followed through." And I thought, what a woman. She has, and she said it without, it wasn't an affectation. It just came naturally. And when she stands before you, you would have that same impression of a woman who is genteel, but who is brilliant, and who gets things done without a lot of fanfare. I won't get into the details of her background, but I will tell you that she is an extraordinary role model and a trailblazer. The award that she received from us was for excellence in leadership, empowerment of women, the enormous work that she has done. You would be delighted to hear from her. I want to mention Gail Masondo also. Gail is better known in the music business as an exec years ago with Warner Brothers, who developed a lot of Grammy award-winning talent and what have you, and did a significant project in South Africa and stayed there to make a difference. She stayed there and married the person she followed her heart. But she stayed to have an impact. And she has done some incredible work that has had a ripple effect in many different countries. She is a chaplain, an author, a producer, a leader, a humanitarian, a mentor. And so she received our Mentoring Excellence Award. Now, you would ask, what does SOHO have to do with women in leadership and social entrepreneurship, social change, economic empowerment? It's simply this. In a country where we work, where women are devalued, the studies have shown that the low value on women is one of the reasons for the prevalence of AIDS in the country. And it makes absolute sense. The lack of economic power on this end, what Dr. Luhabe addresses, has created an incredible generation of children parenting children, because the whole middle part of the social structure has disintegrated. I want to encourage you to check on our website, savingorphans.com, because we've begun a national campaign for hope seekers. I'd like you to be better acquainted with it, and certainly I can be contacted there. For now, join me in welcoming Dr. Wendy Luhabe. You are in for a treat. Dr. Luhabe.
Now let me just share some thoughts about my own life. My own life comprises of many chapters, each of which has been shaped and defined by just the privilege of living in South Africa. And my own chapters have been shaped by South Africa's major themes. And I divide the themes of being a South African into three themes. The first theme is the theme of growing up under an apartheid regime. The second theme is the theme beyond 1976, when young people took to the streets of Soweto to protest against the quality of education for black children in South Africa. A theme that really brought to the attention of the world the brutality and the injustice of apartheid in South Africa. And so that's a theme on its own. And then, of course, the theme of our lives after 1994, when we became a democracy. So these three themes for my generation of women are very dominant in our lives because they shaped us differently. Growing up under an apartheid era meant that we went to segregated schools, so we went to black schools. We lived in segregated residential areas. The career options that our parents had were very limited. As black women, you could only become a nurse or a teacher or a housemaid or a housewife. For men, you could be a mine worker, because it was at the time that we were developing the mining sector in South Africa, or you could be a gardener in someone's home, or you could be a security guard. You know, so the options of the careers that our parents had were very limited. My own breakthrough began when I went to university, a privilege that planted very deep seeds of appreciation for education and the power of education, particularly for women and clearly for girl children in particular, given the work that SOHO is doing and the sense that Cynthia was sharing with you. When I went to university, I was going to become a social worker, and my education life or my university education got disrupted by what happened in 1976 in South Africa. And so I changed universities, and I ended up at a university that did not offer social sciences. So I changed my field of study into commerce, and I graduated in commerce really quite by accident. Not something that I had thought through or that I had been advised to do. I just ended up with that because that's really what happened at during that period. You looked at what people were doing and that's what you followed. And I was no different. There was absolutely nothing special about me. And certainly at that time, other than just recognizing that being educated was probably the most important thing that I could do with my life, I didn't really know much more beyond that. And then my first surprise was after I graduated, which with what I thought was a pretty good degree in commerce, becoming one of the first, amongst the first generation of black women to qualify or to graduate with commerce degree, and I couldn't find a job. I was literally looking for a job for a year. And this really puzzled me. I didn't quite understand why that was the case, because I thought it's if you don't have education that you don't get a job. But if you have education and you have good education, you should have lots of employment opportunities. But this was not the case. When I eventually found a job, it was not through the traditional means of getting employment. I did not get it through an employment agency. I was introduced to someone else who then gave me an opportunity to be employed. This really disturbed me, but it also became a major defining moment in my life in the sense that it taught me that as a person, not necessarily as a black woman, but as a person, I should never compromise what I deserve, that I should never sell myself short as a person. And to recognize that at a young age is a gift that I will always be grateful for, because I was just starting my life. I was in my early 20s, and I suddenly had this epiphany that, okay, so this is how it works. You can either take whatever is available, whether it values or it aligns with the value that you really are, or the worth that you have as a person, or you can actually define the value that you have as a person and find an opportunity that appreciates the value that you have. So that's really how my working life started. I actually had an opportunity to work in the US. I lived here for 3 years in the late 80s, working for a car manufacturing company on the East Coast. And whilst I was here, realized that my passion was not really in what I was doing. And I had over an 8 year period worked in marketing, which was interesting, it was challenging, but it did not inspire me. It did not bring out the best in me. And I wanted to live a life that would absolutely bring out the best in what I had to offer the world. And so whilst I was living here, I decided that the contribution that I really wanted to make had something to do with developing people. And so when I went back to South Africa, having lived here for 3 years, I went back to the company that had sent me here, worked with them for 3 years, and something interesting happened during that 3 years, which served as a catalyst for me to pursue my passion, really. There was a position that became available, which I was overlooked for. I was not even given the opportunity to be interviewed. So I didn't even go through the process that, you know, just even if it's an academic process, to just take me through the process so that I can see for myself whether I qualify for this position or I don't qualify for this position. But it became a blessing in disguise, because when I was not given the opportunity to interview, or when I was not even considered for this opportunity that became available, I had another epiphany. I thought, well, I can decide what I want to do with my life, or I can allow someone else to determine what I'm really capable of. And of course, I chose to go and find out what I was capable of. And so I resigned with nothing really to do. I resigned and I decided to go and start a business in human resources called Bridging the Gap. And what I had done, I had used my own experience and I had used the observations that I had made about what the experiences of black professionals were in South Africa during the 80s and the early 90s. And it became very clear to me that unless we've grown up in being exposed for, let me give you the example that really brought it home to me. If you look at our white peers who would have been at university with us, even though they would have been at white universities and we would have been at black universities, they would have grown up in a home where their parents.
We'll be back with more from the World Affairs Council after this. Under California's three-tiered public school system, the Riverside County Office of Education is the day-to-day interface between the State Department of Education and the county's 23 local districts. The county office is most widely recognized as the sponsor of popular student events. The county office's own school programs serve a wide variety of students outside the educational mainstream. The County Office of Education, serving Riverside County schools since 1893.
And it became very clear to me that unless we've grown up in being exposed for, let me give you the example that really brought it home to me. If you look at our white peers who would have been at university with us, even though they would have been at white universities and we would have been at black universities, they would have grown up in a home where their parents would be corporate executives. So they would have been exposed to what happens in a corporate environment. They probably would have had an opportunity to go to work with their parents when they are on school holidays. And whilst these things may seem irrelevant, they play a major, major role in exposing young people to what world in other realities looks like. And in the case of black students, this was not the case. A lot of our parents would have been the working class. They would not have had university education, and therefore they would not have had senior corporate positions. And so what was happening is that with each generation, we were being thrown into the deep end, basically. We were finding ourselves in an environment that we knew absolutely nothing about. And there was nothing in the corporations themselves that was available to prepare people like myself, who really had absolutely no idea of what are the expectations of a corporate environment, how do I bring out the best in myself, how do I learn to be proactive, so that I can grow within a company. All experiences that ultimately become a disservice to the company themselves, never mind the individuals, because if you don't have a compass as a human being, how do you find your way in the world or in anything that you choose to do? So it was based on those observations that I started my first business to address that need and enable young people who were graduating, who would have never been exposed to a corporate environment, to help them manage that transition so that when they get into a corporate opportunity, they really don't blame the system, but that they have the tools that will enable them to be successful and do the best that they can with the opportunities that they are given. And then on the eve of South Africa's democracy, we were having various discussions about what role black people were going to be playing after South Africa became a free country. And again, I made another observation that these discussions were excluding women. Women were not participating in these discussions. The men were organizing themselves and they were planning what they were going to do, how they were going to participate, and women were not part of this picture. So again, I had an opportunity to to do something about it. I felt that I don't have to do anything because my life is going quite well. I'm self-employed and I'm doing very well in what I'm doing. Or I can change that. And so I approached three other women who were working in the financial services sector and suggested to them that we should look at how we can use the opportunity to become a new nation, to become a democracy, for women to participate meaningfully in the changes that were taking place in South Africa. And this was really what gave birth to a company that we formed called Women Investment Portfolio Holdings, which required us over a period of 2 years to travel throughout the country, educating women of various economic levels, and which is something that surprised me, that even wealthy women did not quite understand how the economy worked. They tended to abdicate to their husbands' issues that were related to financial management. So over a two-year period, we made an investment where we educated women about how the economy functions, what role we can play as women that extends beyond just providing labor to the economy and being consumers of the economy, what would it require for us to become investors in the economy. There's a tradition in South Africa amongst women, primarily black women, that they organize themselves into groups of 10. It's called a stockfell. They create a social structure for themselves. They meet on a monthly basis. They exchange an amount of money amongst themselves that is within their means. And they either rotate the distribution of this money or they put it in a savings account in a bank, and once a year they distribute it amongst themselves. So there was some culture of saving that existed, but there wasn't a culture of investing and creating capital and creating wealth. And that was really the purpose of finding this company. There was a second objective. We recognized that if women don't have access to their own financial resources, their choices in life are limited. They find themselves trapped in circumstances that could be abusive or circumstances that are just not suitable to them. But they don't have options because historically, women got married for someone to look after them. And we wanted to change those realities so that when women get married, they get married for different reasons than to get married for someone else to look after them. And that when women have their own resources, the impact that it will have on their own family to start with and on their communities at large is quite profound. There's a saying in Africa that says, when we educate a woman, we educate a village. So you can imagine if we lived in a society that made it absolutely mandatory for women to be educated, how that would really change the face of society, how that would reduce the incidence of HIV and AIDS, for example, that Cynthia was talking about, and lots of other incidents that really affect women's lives purely because of economic reasons. So this was not just about starting, it was not just about educating women to participate in an economy in their own right, in a meaningful way. It was also about teaching women about the importance of financial independence in their own lives. And the beauty of what we did is that over the first 10 years of creating this company, women made a return of their investments of 300%, which was unheard of. And it was structured such that women could invest as little as $100 or as much as they had. So there was no limit to how much you could invest. And it really became such an equalizer amongst women, and it created a sisterhood as our new democracy was gaining ground that had a huge social impact in South Africa because it showed South African women of all walks of life, black, white, old, young, of what was possible when women come together. And so my sense really is that I was saying to Mohammed at the table, he was asking me to make some comments about the state of the economy, and I'm not an economist, but what I do have a view about the fact that capitalism has outlived its usefulness. We need to define a new economic system that is responsive to the social challenges that exist in our society, because we can't separate these things. We can't say an economy exists somewhere here and everything else happens outside of the economy. We do know today that everything impacts on everything else. So to continue to perpetuate an economic system that leaves behind such huge disparities and such huge poverty gaps and social challenges of a proportion that we have not seen at a time in the world when we are probably the wealthiest, I think is a travesty to humankind, quite frankly. So I think we are probably living through a time that's giving us an opportunity to rethink the role of education, because I don't think that people who are going through the education system are going to continue to be absorbed by the employment sector. I think that we should be educating young people to have more than just the option of being employed. We should be making sure that we are giving them the tools to be entrepreneurs if they choose to become entrepreneurs. We do know that even doctors and accountants and lawyers who start their lives as professional people end up starting their own businesses. But they don't actually have the tools to become entrepreneurs. You know, that needs a completely different mindset. So I think that education has a critical role to play in this transition that we're going through as the human race. And I think that the kind of economy that we choose to create for ourselves, and really we're not creating it for ourselves, we're creating it for...
The World Affairs Council of Inland Southern California is a nonpartisan educational group dedicated to the study of international affairs and foreign policy. Each year it hosts a series of lectures by visiting experts. Lectures are free to students. For more information, contact the World Affairs Council of Inland Southern California, your passport to the world.
To create for ourselves, and really we're not creating it for ourselves, we're creating it for future generations, requires re-evaluation, because the kind of economy that we're living in is just not sustainable. We can see that it's caving in under our feet, yet we continue to hope that it will create miracles and that more growth will resolve social challenges, and that has not really been what has been happening. So those are my thoughts, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for lending me your ears. And as I said, if you haven't been to South Africa, you haven't lived. You need to be there to experience the miracle of living in that country. I have been blessed beyond my wildest dreams. There's a saying that I absolutely love, that God gives us our talents as his gift to us. And how we use those talents is our gift back to God. And I have been truly blessed to be able to do that in my young and short life. Thank you very much.
And Becky was talking about the tipping point that it's necessary for the numbers of women to affect change.
In instances where you have a critical mass of women has not necessarily translated into change for women's lives. I have also seen situations where women are in the minority and they are in a position to effect much greater change. So I'm not sure if really it is a function of numbers or it is a function of what women do when they are in leadership roles. When I was sharing about how we started the women investment company, we were four women, and we were able to mobilize over a two-year period 18,000 women. You know, so you can have a small number of women that can have a much greater impact. I don't necessarily think that if there were 20 of us, we would have done much more. And sometimes it's much easier to get something accomplished when there's a much smaller number of women in a leadership role, because otherwise we get involved in other dynamics that are well known to all of us.
My name is Gail Hamilton Masondo, and I'm a transplant from this country to South Africa. And I've been involved in a number of projects that I've started with one or two women. One project was called Isililo, which is loosely translated, meaning mother's cry. And that project was to have a response as opposed to a reaction to the rash of baby rapes that was happening in South Africa about 6 years ago. And we as women wanted to mobilize and come up with the why. What was happening and how could we be a part of the solution? Out of that Isililo project, we determined that we needed a, just because of the residue of apartheid and how it pulled families apart, we recognized that we needed professional help within our communities. So goes the family, so goes the community, so goes the nation. And so we developed a family abuse prevention center, which is in Soweto, and that we provide psychological counseling and a way for the community to reconnect to itself. I wanted to respond to your comment. I'm not a great believer in numbers either. I think I grew up with the motto from my mom that said, make yourself a committee of one. That doesn't suggest that, you know, no man's an island. That's the truth of the matter. But sometimes you can wait. I'm an intimate, you know, I'm an intimate kind of person. I think we as women do better when we're clear, first of all, about the focus and create balance in those situations. But if you wait for the gang, then you're gonna have gang-related problems. But if you believe in yourself, that's number one. That's the number one number. If you believe in yourself and believe in the project or the idea, there's something about God being a part of that belief and him guiding and directing and bringing the people that need to be in your life to do what needs to be done. And that's not always a bunch of numbers.
I agree that you know, critical mass, it's really all relative. I think what's important is the few essential elements. One is timing. Wendy perceived that the country was going to be in political transition, positioned herself to be a part of positive change when that transition took place. So the element of timing, being sensitive to what kind of environment you are in, and to be able to create opportunity as a result of your awareness of where you are. I like that she didn't curse. You don't curse the darkness. You see the darkness as an opportunity to create light. So there's timing. Another is temperament. When I had a speaking engagement the first time in Namibe and a couple of other parts of Southern Africa, I hadn't been there. But my defining moment came when I faced 1,000 orphans on a daily basis, 5 days a week, because I'd done some TV interviewing and raised enough money to feed all of them. I couldn't go back to what I had been doing, which was HR consulting. But the person who associated me with me was a nurse case management company business owner by the name of Linda Schultz, just one of a kindred spirit that understood the need and understood the possibility. And so timing, temperament, and the last is tools. Knowing that if it is one, if it is two, if it's three, that the tools that you have complement each other so that you end up with a complete whole, because you each bring your strength to the table and create something wonderful. Rosa Parks was a company of one who decided, I will no longer sit at the back of the bus, and change took place.
Okay, the question is about the link between female empowerment and having control over your own reproductive rights.
Talk about family planning. My mother-in-law got married at 16, had 14 children. I mean, I thought one was a challenge to have, 14 children. And as far as she was concerned, she planned adequately because they all ended up with positions of leadership somewhere in the world. But that little story aside, I serve in a country that is evidence of what happens when women are not able to claim ownership of their own persons. In Swaziland, if a woman asks her husband to use a contraceptive, she's likely to get a beating. She can't go to the cops and she can't ask for a restraining order because they'll send her back, go home and behave yourself. So what you have is if a man plays and a woman knows that her husband is potentially infected, she knows that it's going to be passed on to her, and she doesn't feel the strength to do something about it. As far as economic empowerment is concerned, I think a part of it has to do with the woman's own self-determination and how she relates to the culture in which she is, what kind of inner strength she has to make the very hard decisions that if I know this man is playing and has AIDS, what are my alternatives? If I cannot be safe with him, then I need to find a way to support myself. Unfortunately, what most of them do is they just simply know they're going to have AIDS, and 65% of the population of AIDS-affected people are women. So, you know, there are different ways of looking at it. There's some political nuances here, but I do believe that God created the woman's body, and it was really a relationship between her and him. And if she cannot respect, and if she cannot value and protect what God has given her, then there's a deficiency somewhere that is going to show up economically, socially, psychologically, spiritually.
I worked in North Home, Minnesota, which is on the tip of Minnesota, almost going into Canada, and I worked for a medical doctor at the time, and he had about 6 different Native American reservations that he was the physician for. And one of the things that we did back then in the almost mid-70s were we were taking birth control pills and actually passing them out to the Indian woman. And then we'd come back to follow up, you know, in another 2 or 3 weeks, and we'd find the pills on the floor, and you would find a 2 or 3 year old or the 9-month-old baby eating the birth control pills. We would ask the question, you know, and I just want to put it in context because we're talking about Africa, but I want to bring it home. We were asking the question, you know, of the mother of the home, why aren't you taking the pills? And she would have the similar answer. And that the man felt like he did not have a good job. He could not provide for his family, but he could produce children. And this somehow showed his status or whatever in his poor community. We talked a couple of days ago, and we talked about the need now for us as women, as parents, as mothers, since you mentioned, you know, we all are married, we all have children, the need to parent differently our daughters. We can't really do anything about the past, but we can certainly look towards the future. And if we're parenting our daughters differently in how to value themselves and how to take care of themselves, then certain decisions will be made differently. And then the economic question and family planning all make sense. But if we try to divide it, then we're in a mess like we are, you know, right now. So it's like the structure of the family, particularly in South Africa. I can't speak about the rest of Africa. The residue of that is apartheid, and the family was ripped apart. We have to figure out a way to connect that back together again. But here in America as well, there are some families. I was so happy to walk in the room, actually, and see so many sages. We call sages those of you who are over 65. Because, you know why? Because there's wisdom. When the community of all ages can come together, this really is an indaba. This really is a village setting where you have the seniors who offer a certain amount of wisdom. And we need to come together more often and speak about these very issues. How can our daughters feel better about themselves so that the choices of relationship, the choices of career, the choices of finances are very different than the choices that are being made, you know, even now?
Really, just to add to what's been said, I think the parenting for me is not just about bringing up our girls differently. It's also about bringing up our girls different. I mean, our boys differently. Mm-hmm. It's both girls and boys. Mm-hmm. Because I think in South Africa, certainly in the last 20 years or so, where women have taken on a completely different role from our traditional roles, men are finding themselves displaced, and I don't know if our Consul General has some comments to make about that. Because the traditional role of a man was to look after their family. And that role is gone because women are now educated, they are professional women, and they are having children later, or they are not having children at all. And that's why I think that education is really at the heart of it. Education is at the heart of changing society and the values that hold within them prejudice, that disadvantage genders. The other thing that I think we're not doing particularly well as a society is to pass on our own experience to future generations. So we are allowing our children to have or to make the same mistakes that we made. We are not creating platforms. I'll give you an example of what I offered in South Africa. A daughter of a friend, of family friends, was getting married. And I offered her as a gift to arrange the friends of the mother to meet with her and share our own experiences of being married. And there were about 8 of us. We'd been married minimum of 20 years, up to 40 years. So we had a wealth of experience. And we just had a conversation with her about marriage. We don't do that. We make an assumption that our daughters have an understanding of what marriage requires from them. And I think we do that with everything. We do that with their careers, you know, so I think that we need to be more deliberate in how we manage the transitions and bringing our experience to share with our children and younger generations so that they can manage their transitions much more effectively than they are currently doing. Because in the absence of that, all that they have is really to look at the way that we've done it. And the way that we've done it is generally not suitable for their generation because we can see how fast the world is changing around us. You know, that when we wake up tomorrow, what we knew today is already, you know, obsolete. So how much more about our children who have to go through marriage? Because that doesn't change. You know, society will still have to go through marriage, will still have to parent, you know, bring up children. So these functions continue to be fulfilled, but because the environment is so vastly different, they need to be approached differently.
And energized.
Big question. Well, the first thing I would do is to to say that no one should be a leader of any country if they are above the age of 50 as a start, because that would go a long way in having the kinds of conversations that you're suggesting. But I think what we have to recognize is that the future of the world is really not going to comprise of just employees as it has been for many years. The future economy is going to be shaped primarily by entrepreneurs, because entrepreneurship creates creativity, it brings innovation, it encourages people to self-actualize, because I've seen it in my own life. When I left, if I compare with what I achieved when I was employed and what I've achieved in a more or less the same period of time in what I've achieved being on my own and really taking risks and finding out what I'm capable of, there is no comparison. And I think that ultimately every human being does want to self-actualize, but I don't think that institutions are designed to make it possible for people to self-actualize. I don't think that institutions know how to utilize people to the extent that they really grow and they contribute. So that's why I was saying earlier that we need to review the role of education, because that's where it starts. We need to be educating people to go and work if they choose to, but to also accept that they will most likely be self-employed. They will most likely become entrepreneurs at some point in their life. So we might as well give them the tools whilst they are going through the education system and educate them in a way that really reawakens the whole idea of innovation, of creating new things. If I look at South Africa, over the last 20 years that we've become a democracy, we have not created many new industries. We created much more during the apartheid era than we've been able to create as a free nation. So you have to ask yourself, why is that? Why were we not able to generate the highest level of innovation and creativity as a free country than we were able to achieve as a country that was not free? So a lot of these things, in my view, need to be deliberate. We need to be conscious about what we're doing, because they have far-reaching implications.
For those who are teaching microfinance and social entrepreneurship, what would you like those professors to be teaching their students?
I'm a New York City girl, but I spent a lot of my time in North Carolina with my great aunts, and I had 9 great aunts that grew up through the period of 1916 to 1930. And my grandfather was the first son of a free slave, taught himself how to read and write, and had 9 daughters, and made the decision that those 9 daughters would have higher education. 3 of my aunts were entrepreneurs, and I was sitting here thinking, just listening, that I've never worked for anybody in my life. I've never had to punch in a clock. I've been very fortunate to be able to create my own way. My husband has never worked for anyone. But going back to my grandfather and his 9 daughters, one of my great aunts opened up one of the first hair salons, yay, and in Staten Island. Do any of you here? Because I'm talking about the North compared, or the East compared to the West. But in the African American community, whenever we needed anything, the church would have fried chicken, fish fries, and spaghetti dinners. Anybody? And we built churches, and we put kids through school. And we were proud of the money. I remember hearing my aunts talk about, yeah, girl, we raised X amount of dollars, free, no tax, no. I don't know what happens now, but that was creative input, creative energy, taking something very small and making something really happen. I am on the continent of Africa, and I am always taken back by the creativity on the continent as it relates to handcraft. There are women who do amazing work. That doesn't answer your question about how to teach your students, but I suppose what I'm really trying to get at, we talked about tools, Cynthia talked about tools, and finding out what are the talent base, you know, what are the tools. I'm so glad that Albert Einstein really wasn't great in school, was he? He wasn't great in school. I beg your pardon? Yeah, he flunked. There are many that, but decided to take a different path. They didn't get stuck. And I suppose, as a young professor, because I don't want to say teacher if you're a professor, but as a young professor, it is to energize that talent base, which Wendy is saying, you know, education has to be turned around. I'm a right brain person. I didn't do very well in maths and science, but I was an excellent writer and in English and in drama, you know, but there was no place for me because, you know, we gear the educational system. So you're young enough to be able to change the status quo. You can do that. We want you to do that. Give her a clap. Tell her, yay, go ahead and do that.
Now, I'm fascinated by this discussion. How do you prepare a generation of future change agents to think independently, to think creatively, and go do what they need to do? Three thoughts occurred to me. One is that just teaching them the basic skills that give them business acumen alone won't do it. There are a lot of very bright, academically trained, genius types who are not successful. Not successful in life, not successful in business, and not successful in relationships. And so I think if you're looking at developing a generation of social entrepreneurs, the first thing that you do is teach them the courage to follow their own convictions, the independent thinking. My husband, Philip, didn't know that he had what you call in the industry a nose, that he was a perfumer. He didn't know he had that gift. He was a low-level research chemist with Elizabeth Arden. When the Lilly Company purchased Elizabeth Arden and moved the company to Indianapolis, he realized that the high-priced European perfumers weren't solving a Lagerfeld problem that was going to cost the company millions. And in the process, because he had been interested and been absorbing knowledge and really stimulating something that was his internally, he was able to solve in 2 days what the perfumers had not been able to solve, and so they made him a perfumer. What evolved out of that was the development of his own perfume brand. Now, here you are, a black person. You're not supposed to be a perfumer because it's an inside secret handed down within European families. I'm not talking about pouring oil. I'm talking about fine fragrance creation. You have to have what they call a nose and break things down, you know, analyze and do things. Well, he was able, you know, I assisted him with that in the marketing end of it, of developing a fragrance. Now you need $14 million to do just marketing with less than $1 million of investment. Develop a fragrance that premiered at Bergdorf. Beyonce can't get her stuff to Bergdorf. And the point that I'm making here is you teach them to think courageously. Okay? The second is that they develop competence in the area. You run into a lot of young people who have brilliant ideas and they don't want to build the competence within themselves to be able to do things well. They think that if they give a good talk and they look really good and they have some basic knowledge that they could go do everything and be successful. So the courage, the competence, and the last thing is their ability to collaborate, to see you know, to understand what are your strengths. You can't be strong in everything under the sun. So you do very well. They learn to do very well what they can do, but learn to be able to collaborate with others. You grow and you're able to develop a better product. The last thing I would suggest that you teach them is how to have balance in life and how to celebrate. Sometimes they're so driven that they can't, after one win, it's another, and it's the competing, and they have no quality of life, they burn out or they burn up. And so, you know, teach just the basics, the skills to be able to succeed, but also the principles of living the life intentionally, I think would take them a long way.
One other thing, I was given from my family this small little slogan, and it does work. I remembered it. It's good, better, best. Never let them rest until your good is better and your better is your best. Just a slogan that keeps you moving forward. And fear cripples. So the ability to not to ignore apprehension, but not to let apprehension paralyze.
A lot of us have a fear of failure. And I think we need to teach young people to be comfortable with it. Because there's a lot that we can learn from failure. It builds character. That's where you find your courage. The next thing that I would teach them is to be whole human beings. I think that part of the challenge we see in the world, one of the reasons why there's a leadership vacuum in my view, is that we have human beings who are not whole human beings. We need to develop the next generations to have social intelligence, spiritual intelligence, and emotional intelligence. I think that's what's missing in the world. And then the third thing I would teach them is critical thinking, to ask questions. You know, we somehow just accept what we are told. We accept what is. We've become lazy. You know, so I think we need to teach young people to question. And we do that as we are bringing them up when the children are curious. We kill that curiosity. By the time they are five, it's gone. You know, all that we've done is to bring up robots. So we need to be cultivating that sense of curiosity as they are young, as they are asking the questions. Let's engage them. Because that's when that creativity really develops and blossoms and grows. But we can't expect people as adults to suddenly find their creative genius, you know, when we destroyed it by the age of five, and then try to educate them to be creative. But I don't believe in that. I think creativity is something that we nurture from a young age, and we keep it alive as we go through the different stages of our existence.
We're very excited you've had this program tonight, celebrating everything you want to celebrate. Thank you.